Iguchukwu, investment research analyst at AfriInvest Securities, joins us now. Good morning, Benedict. Thank you very much for joining us.
For having me.
Now, in its World Economic Outlook report titled Managing Divergent Recoveries, the IMF revised its 2021 growth forecast for Nigeria to 2.5%. Is this in line with AfriInvest's projection?
Interestingly, the new IMF projection for Nigeria in 2021 aligns with our 2021 growth forecast as contained in our 2020 review and 2021 outlook report titled A Blurry Pathway Recovery. And this further kind of reinforces our position that Nigeria's pathway recovery will be blurry with no hope of a near-term improvement in the average standard of living of the citizens. I mean, given the improvements we saw in IMF's projection from 1.5% to 2.5%, Nigeria's economic growth is still expected to lag the annual population growth rate of 2.6% we see on a yearly basis, whereas the country requires a minimum GDP growth rate of about 5.2%, that is two times our population growth rate, continuously for a medium-term period to achieve inclusive and sustainable growth that will translate into improved living standards for its average citizens. Unfortunately, it is very tough for the economy to achieve such a strong and sustainable GDP growth because of the resolving structural problems that have driven inflation rate to a four-year high of about 17.3% as at February. Employment rate has risen up to an all-time high of about 33.1%, while the official exchange rate depreciated by about 92.4% within a five-year period. That is from 197 naira to the dollar in 2016 to about 379 naira to the dollar in 2020. And they also have some heightened external vulnerability that currently affects the Nigeria economy all around. So we just believe that though the projection by the IMF is optimistic, we believe that in order for us to really ensure that that comes to pass, as well as do much better given the economic lag in our annual population growth rate, the Nigerian government must allow private sector players to get involved in the provision and maintenance of critical infrastructures such as power, road networks, and this way, in a way, lead and improve local business activities, boost production of goods and competitive prices, create more jobs for the economy, and reduce the FX pressure for import bills.
All right, Benedict. Although oil is, trending higher, what many analysts would say is positive news for Nigeria, as it will support the accretion of the reserves. But the issue of deregulation of the downstream sector has been a major challenge. The government has continued to pay a subsidy as Nigerians can't afford a hike in fuel price owing to the rise in oil prices. In fact, the government has deferred the removal subsidy for another about 6 months. What would this mean for investment into the country?
Well, considering the situation, it's actually an easy matter. Like, if you consider some of the deterrents in attracting private sector investment, it has just been inconsistent policy on the part of the government. Now, including the delay of the removal of subsidy and the complete deregulation of the downstream segment of the oil and gas, we just believe that this will further delay the pace of any investment within the oil and gas sector. So in a situation where we find poor inconsistency or uncertainty in an industry due to policy being issued by the government, no investor would want to invest fund where there is little clarity and determination on the government to open up that in particular industry.
Now, we know that we're talking about investment now, and of course you're talking about attracting the private sector to actually invest in the country. Insecurity is a hydro-headed problem for Nigeria. How do you see this also impacting on this growth projection that we are seeing now, and of course the needed investment that we are talking about?
Okay, so if we take a look back, we've noticed that insecurity has contributed to the contraction of Nigeria's growth rate for about 5% prior to 2014. And this has remained sticky at just about 2% below population growth rates. And the country has been unable to break this cycle over the past 5 years. So insecurity has major implications for both the non-oil sector and the oil sector as well. With farmers in the non-oil sector, the farmers and herders clash up in the north, affecting agriculture. Then we have the porous borders affecting trade, and then militancy impacting on the crude oil production in the Niger Delta region. So though we see that there's been relative peace in key oil producing region, the resurgence in the farmers herders clash, terrorism and kidnapping could tame the pace of growth in the non-oil sector. And if you take a look at the GDP report that came out as of Q4 2020, we realized that the major growth within the economy came from the non-oil sector, mostly the ICT, the agriculture, and the financial service industry. So any insecurity challenges like the farmer head clash, terrorism, and kidnapping that actually prolongs further, this could in a way affect the expected growth Nigeria aims to achieve in 2021.
All right, let's look at the equities market now. It was ranked as the best performing stock markets in the world with an annual return of 50% at the end of the first quarter of 2021. And we noticed that the markets closed at a loss of 3.0%. What can you say about this underwhelming performance?
Okay, well, following the outstanding performance we saw in full year 2021 actually started on a positive note. And this is actually in line with past trend, what we've seen in previous years. Usually at the start of the year, the equities market is booming. And as at the end of January, the equities market recorded a growth of about 5.3%. And this was as a result of expectations from corporate actions, that is our dividends and our bonuses. However, in February, this uptrend in the market was reversed as the stock market began a negative trend, declining about 6.2% month on month and 1.2% year to date. The unimpressive performance we saw in February trickled down into March, and the market lost around 3% in Q1 2020. And this is despite the impressive corporate actions announced by some of the listed companies we have on the Nigerian stock exchange markets. Now, if we now take a look at the sector performance, we'll notice that within the sector, there were only three sectors that gained. So the oil and gas sector actually led the pack with a return of 17.5%, and this was on the back of gains in Seplat. And then we saw the insurance and our Afi Invest ICT index rise by 7.9% and 1.4% respectively. But on the other hand, the industrial goods and the banking sectors were the worst performance, with about 7.9% and 5.9% negative return respectively. And the consumer goods also fell likewise by about 5.3%. Now, the poor performance we saw in Q1, we could attribute it to the improvements in the rate of fixed income instruments witnessed in February. And this has reduced the interest of the PFAs and domestic institutional investors in the stock market, as dividend yield became less attractive when compared to the return from investment in the fixed income instruments. So in the equities market, we just expect that moving forward, especially in Q2 2020, that Nigeria's stock market will remain down. And this is because of the continued increase in fixed income rate. As a result, we expect investors to remain cautious and just target companies that will deliver dividend yield of over 10% within the next 12 months. And this also implies that stock prices are going to come down to an attractive entry point at the end of Q2. So investors can wait and try to enter into the market in Q3 when some companies will possibly be paying some interim dividend.
Now, so far in 2021, we have seen an increase in fixed income yields, specifically treasury bills of about 7%. How do you contextualize the rise in yields amidst an accommodative monetary policy stance of the central bank to curb the impact of COVID-19 on the economy?
Okay. Now, because of the COVID period, the CBN has had to implement an accommodative policy stance and regime in order to stimulate growth via cheap credit. And from what we saw in Q4 2020 in GDP, we registered a growth of about 0.1%, although marginal, but it shows that the CBN's efforts with the accommodative policy is actually yielding fruits. And normally, if you take a look at an accommodative monetary policy environment, falling interest rate will definitely lead to a rise in bond prices and then a fall in the bond yields. However, what we've seen in the Nigerian economy is a rise in the fixed income yields. And And this is as a result of, we believe that this is as a result of investors pushing for higher yields in the market because of the rising inflation, because the amount currently some investors are carrying some negative real returns on their portfolio and they're looking for ways to earn more positive returns. And one way of doing that is just to ask for more yields within the fixed income space. So we just believe that the CBN will have to find a way to harmonize the interest rate and the market yield within H2 2021.
All right, Benedict, inflation numbers for March will be published tomorrow. What is AfriInvest's projection?
Well, we don't really expect anything different from what we've been seeing of late. We still expect inflation to be on the rise. So we believe the risk to inflation will still remain high over the near medium term. And food prices will continue to pressure headline inflation as we have exited the harvest season. And also, we've seen food insecurity in the north. This could also bring food prices, which could also, like I said, put pressure on the headline inflation. And then unrelenting farmer head clash may disrupt the planting season. And we also expect that increased pressure on the core inflation, we could see increased pressure on the core inflation if the new pricing template for PMS is adopted later on within the year.
All right, thank you very much, Benedict Egochukwu, for joining us on the program. We do appreciate your time and do enjoy the rest of the day.
Thank you very much.